Thank you so much for inviting me. It's a great honor to give a talk at conference and John. I think I met John first time probably 24 years ago in 1998. But in any case, at that time, around that time, I read some papers of John, in particular joint paper with Tracy and Widom on spacings and random matrices. So it's been a long time. And again, it's a pity that I couldn't come in person to Montreal. Probably it's great in December. It's finals week in Davis. I give two final exams and we have TAs on strike. So it's a perfect storm. In any case, I will talk about several papers I wrote, most of them with my former graduate students. Ander Aguirre is now a postdoc at Ohio State. Josh Sumter is a postdoc at University of Rochester. And there is most recent paper where I sort of give simpler proof for higher order correlations. I will mention it. One sec. So this very approximate plan of the talk, I will briefly mention circular bit ensembles. Then I'll briefly talk about CLT central limit theorem for bit ensembles. I will then talk about motivation from number theory. I will mention Montgomery's theorem and Rudnick-Sarnak theorem. And then I will explain our results and probably talk a little bit about proof, I mean, at least in the most interesting regime, in the local regime. Okay, so that's the plan. And the most interesting part will depend on some properties of cumulants, random matrices. All right. So for arbitrary positive values of parameter beta, circular bit ensemble corresponds to the joint probability density on the torus. So we have n particles on the inner circle, theta 1, et cetera, 10. Their joint probability density is given by this formula that probably many know. I just write it for completeness. There is normalization constant, of course, partition bucket. And few things about this formula. First, one can think about circular bit ensemble as a log Gauss. You have really system of n particles at temperature inverse beta repelling each other, right? You have the potential. You can also view it as a stationary distribution of circular Dyson-Brownian motion. You have particles, and again, you see repulsion here. And the last simple comment is that there are three special values of beta 1, 2, and 4. They correspond to famous circular orthogonal symplectic, unitary and symplectic ensembles. And I will briefly mention it later as well. So there is a matrix model for arbitrary beta. And again, I'm pretty sure that Tamara touched on it. In 2004, Killip and Nencho introduced a sparse random matrix model for circular bit ensemble for arbitrary beta. We consider a one parameter family of complex random variables supporting the inner circle. And with the help of these random variables, we construct this 2x2 matrices, building blocks. And then once these building blocks are here, we consider two n by n log diagonal matrices, and the product of L, M, N will give us a random matrix with eigenvalues distributed according to circular bit ensemble. And there are many other wonderful developments that sort of were originated after this research. And of course, the original idea goes back to Dumitru and Edelman, who studied some similar ensemble on the real line a bit earlier. Very briefly, I will mentioned that beta equal 2, 1, 4 are indeed very special cases. For beta equal 2, you just really consider eigenvalues of a random unitary matrix. So you have Hermitian the unitary group, and then you have the eigenvalues distributed by this formula for beta equal 2. For beta equal 1 and 4, the situation is not that much more complicated. In particular, for beta equal 1, you just consider the product of the transpose of random unitary matrix in the cell. So you obtain a symmetric random unitary matrix. And for beta equal 4, you consider dual quaternion multiplied by U. So again, there are three very special cases, and there are many wonderful explicit formulas in these special cases. And just a picture that, again, many of you know, but particularly for beta equal 2, if you consider dimension 30, so you have a 30 by 30 random unitary matrix, consider its eigenvalues. On the left, you'll see this eigenvalues. And you can compare with Poisson point process on the right. You'll see that on the left, the configuration is much more regular than purely random configurations, right? So you have strong repulsion. Finally, just to finish the introduction, let me very briefly mention that about what, 35 years ago already, probably, there was a wonderful paper by Kurt Johansen, who studied linear statistics in circle bit ensemble. So you start with sufficiently smooth functions in circle, has slightly more than one derivative. And you consider appropriate linear statistic. You centralize it. And then, without any normalization, the centralized random variable in the limit has Gaussian distribution with the variance given by this explicit formula. For beta equal 2, this result holds under optimal condition. If beta is not 2, actually, you have to be more careful. And one can also study mesoscopic regime. There's a paper by Lambert, 2019, 3 years ago. Again, you consider sufficiently smooth function on the real line, let's say with compact support. You have Ln, which grows to infinity, but slower than n, slightly slower than n, much smaller than n divided by log n to the power 3. And then you can study somewhat similar thing. But again, this statistics is rescaled because you have Ln inside the argument here. So basically, you study the behavior of the eigenvalues in the neighborhood of 1 over Ln around, say, the origin, right? And you still have Gaussian flotation. And there is a related development classical paper by Diakonis and Shahani, 1994, which basically points to the following remarkable phenomena. You consider random unitary matrix, UM. You consider powers of this matrix, let's say first k powers, u, u squared, u cubed, et cetera, up to u to the power k. And then you have this k complex random variables, and you study joint moments of this k complex random variables. And the very interesting phenomenon is that if n, the size of the matrix, goes to infinity, then after a certain moment, after a certain value of n, the joint moments are exactly equal to the joint moments of appropriately scaled independent Gaussian, standard Gaussian n variables. So you have to scale because the variance will grow as J, but other than that, you have this identity. And again, this exact identity, there is no error term. For arbitrary beta, the situation is slightly more complicated, but there's a remarkable paper by Matsumoto and Zhang in 2014 that showed that basically, okay, you don't have, of course, the correct identity, but if you look at this joint moments, and here I consider very special case, I mean, they studied something slightly more complicated, but in particular, you can look at this expression on the line 5 from the bottom. Again, it's basically asymptotically given by what you see for beta equal 2, because this capital A and capital B constants converge to 1 pretty quickly if needed. Okay. All right. So this is the story about linear statistics in so-called beta ensembles. And now what we study. Pair correlation statistics and higher order correlation statistics. In the case of pair correlations, essentially the question is to study objects of the following nature. You consider sufficiently smooth function f, this function. You have a rescaling factor that ranges from 1 to n. When this factor ln is 1, it's a global case. When this factor is n, it's a local case, and you can study something in between, mesoscopic case. You start by looking at the eigenvalues of a circular beta ensemble random matrix, and you consider the following statistics written here on line 4, SNF, that's the notation. And the question, what happens when the size of the matrix goes to infinity? Again, one can study global regime, mesoscopic regime, and local regime, as I indicated at the bottom of this page. One can also study higher order correlations, and you'll see it in future slides. Again, you can consider function of several arguments and can study higher order correlations. But the question is, what can you say about the limiting distribution? Right, and again, in the case of higher order correlations, you do something pretty similar, right? You have a test function on Rn, right? Maybe this complex support sufficiently smooth. And then you consider this generalized version of similar statistic. And again, the question is, what can be said about the limiting distribution? Now, this problem was motivated by number theory. And in the next few slides, I will explain the connection to number theory. So basically, there's a connection with Riemann zeta function. If you look at the Riemann zeta function, and of course, all of us know that there is fantastic conjecture about non-trivial zeros of Riemann zeta function that sort of originate after Riemann was able to obtain functional equation. If you look at this functional equation, you can see that there are trivial zeros, negative even numbers, and then all remaining non-trivial zeros must be in the critical strip when the real part of S is between strictly between 0 and 1. And there is a conjecture, Riemann hypothesis, that says that all non-trivial zeros must be on the line when real part of S is equal to 1/2, called the critical line. Now, of course, there are many, many fantastic developments about it. And just to mention that, again, Brian Connery, about 33 years ago now, proved that at least 40% of non-trivial zeros are on the critical line. And there are many, many things that one can mention, but probably it's not needed here. But what is important is that Montgomery, 1973, assuming Riemann hypothesis, studied the distribution of non-trivial zeros by essentially studying pair counting statistics. So what I mean by this is the following. Let's assume Riemann hypothesis consider non-trivial zeros. Then let us rescale them. We have simple rescaling formula. The reason for this rescaling is that you want on average non-trivial zeros to be evenly spaced. So again, if you do consider this rescaling and ask for the number of rescaled zeros in a long window from zero to t, then in the limit, again, it grows like t, right? So if you consider this rescaled zeros and ask yourself, what can be said about the statistical properties, right? One way to study the statistical properties is would be to study pair counting statistics of the following form. So you consider rescaled zeros in the window from zero to t, right? You start with some very nice test function f on the real line, and you consider this double sum, right? You sum over all pairs of rescaled zeros in that window, and you normalize it appropriately, because if function f decays at infinity, it's not very hard to see that indeed the sum must grow like t. Right? So what Montgomery obtained was that under technical conditions that the Fourier transform of f has compact support inside interval minus one, one, Montgomery studied the limit of this statistics when t goes to infinity. So basically what Montgomery did was he considered this limit capital F of alpha, as you can see on the slide, right? For rigorously, he proved the existence of this limit for alpha in absolute value not bigger than one. And then he shows that for alpha in absolute value not bigger than one, the limit is indeed absolute value of alpha. And they already mentioned about this technical conditions as a Fourier transform of F must have support inside interval minus on one, basically rephrasing it. And Montgomery also gave heuristic arguments that if alpha in absolute value is bigger than one, then the limit must be one. It wasn't proven rigorously, but heuristics is nice. So one can note that this limit can be written as a Fourier transform of something that makes is important in random metric theory in circular ensembles. What I mean by this is that one can, this result could be interpreted. Montgomery's result could be interpreted in the sense that two-point correlations of Riemann zeta function behave as two-point correlations of eigenvalues of a large unitary or Hermitian random matrix. And of course, everybody, I assume everybody knows about the story of Montgomery talking to Dyson Institute for Advanced Study, and Dyson pointed out to Montgomery about this connection, right? So basically, we started doing research on this subject after, really I just talked to undergraduate students about it. I tried to generate some interest in random metric theory, GCDS. Students, I told this story because it's obviously a very easy story to tell to make people interested. And one of the students asked them what can be done in random metric theory about the fluctuation of this counting statistics. So, and again, if you want to think about connection of Montgomery result to random metric theory, one has to consider this local regime. So if you look at the bottom two lines of the slide, this is statistics you want to study, right? You scale your eigenvalues in such a way that the spacing between them is 4 to 1, right? the same way the non-trivial zeros of Riemann zeta function were scaled in such a way that spacing between them is one on average. Okay. So, and after Montgomery, James Hetchel in 1994, and then Zeev Rudnik and Peter Sarnik in 1996 considered higher order correlations. Hetchel considered case of triple correlations, and Rudnik and Sarnik considered arbitrary case. So again, basically what it means is that you start for arbitrary integer L not smaller than two with a symmetric function of L variables, right, which is translation invariant and decays rapidly on the hyperplane, sorry. And then assuming Riemann hypothesis, and again, adding this always present technical condition that the Fourier transform of this test function must be complexly supported, and complex support cannot be too big, must be subset of this domain. Then the result was that, again, if you study this statistic, and I'm pretty sure that I forgot to normalize it here. I'm very sorry. Of course, it must be normalized by profit by 1 over T. You have to multiply by 1 over T here. Then in the limit, you get the answer dictated by randomatic theory. Specifically, if you look at this function rho lambda, just the L point correlation function in the circular unit ensemble with a famous sign kernel. So this is the result by Rudnik and Sarnik 1996. So the question again, can we study similar statistic and arithmetic theory and study the fluctuation of it? So here I will mention the results, and maybe close to the end of the lecture, I will talk about technical difficulties in interesting cases. The global regime is basically boring, it's almost trivial. For most of the lecture, we'll talk about pair counting statistics, but just because the formulas are slightly nicer to read. But again, recently I posted a preprint online where the proof actually simplified and holds for higher order statistics as well. Anyway, let's talk about pair counting statistics. So in the global regime, you literally just consider the sum Sn, right? You have this double sum. And what's going on is that once you centralize it, and one can study asymptotics of this Mayakovsky expectation, I will mention it later, then there is no need for normalization. And the limiting distribution is given by this series where randomness comes from this phi k random variables that are exponential random variables. So it's if your function test function f is trigonometric polynomial. Of course, this is just a finite sum of independent random variables. In general, it's infinite sum. And for beta equal to, this result holds under optimal condition. So that actually requires a little bit of work. For beta not equal to two, you have to consider slightly more restrictive assumptions on your test function. I'm not going to into details here, but just for completeness, I put it on the slide. And for completeness, I wrote here the expression from mathematical expectation of the statistic. Again, for beta equal to, you have exact formula for beta not equal to two, you can study it asymptotically. But that's what it is. Now, for beta equal to, we can also study the case of slowly growing variance. Basically, similar to result of Deaconis and Evans for CUE for linear statistics. In other words, if you consider this expression Vn, which is not exactly the variance in the case of CU, but basically the leading term, the rest is negligible. Then if this sequence Vn is slowly growing, then after appropriate normalization, the fluctuation becomes Gaussian. So again, if the variance doesn't grow, the fluctuation is on Gaussian. You probably remember we had this sum that involved exponential n variables. If the variance is growing, which corresponds to the function, test function f to be not that smooth, right? Then after normalization, the fluctuation is Gaussian. And next step would be to consider mesoscopic regime. So you have this factor ln that grows to infinity, but slower than n. You consider nice test function, smooth test function with compact support on the real line. And you scale the test function f and extend it to pi periodically. Then under the technical condition for arbitrary beta, which we do not need for beta equal 2, but for arbitrary beta, we need this technical condition that the scaling factor ln doesn't grow too fast. Then one can study pair counting statistic in the mesoscopic regime. And there is a joint paper with Under and Josh Sumter, when we showed that in that case, after appropriate normalization, the fluctuation is Gaussian, and we did obtain the limiting variance. Okay. And finally, let me scratch the local case a little bit. And again, for simplicity, I just consider pair counting situation, but we have results now for high order correlations as well. So in the pair counting case, consider this counterpart to what Montgomery studied, right? This is sort of statistics that you're interested, that is motivated by number theoretical considerations. So again, you start with a nice test function, complex supported functions, real line, right? And now you have random point configuration from CUE, and you consider this double sum, right? And what one can prove is that once you centralize and normalize the square root of n, then the limiting distribution is Gaussian, and there is this formula for the limiting variance. And again, one can obtain similar results if you consider higher order correlations as well. The formula for the variance, of course, becomes more involved, but there is explicit formula. So now, finally, I will talk a little bit about the proofs. I will convince you that in the global case and mesoscopic case, the proofs are pretty standard and actually pretty long. Without, if one does not look at the proof under most general assumptions on test functions, then the ideas are very simple, actually. If you want to consider the proof under optimal conditions, then you have to work. But the whole idea, the real idea, is very simple. So consider the global case, right? So what we do here, we consider circular bit ensemble, right? We consider this double sum. We have random point configuration. We have n eigenvalues, theta 1, theta, capital N. And one can immediately reduce studying the statistics to the equation of the traces of powers of your random unitary matrix, right? Just using Fourier transform, one can immediately rewrite it in the form in the middle of the slide. The beauty is that, of course, the traces of the powers of a random unitary matrix are asymptotically Gaussian in the limit, right? And therefore, if you take absolute value squared of these traces, you get random variable, which is exponentially distributed with appropriate mean. And basically, that's it. If your test function is really, really nice, right? You have to work harder if you want to extend this result to the, if you want to prove it under optimum conditions, of course, but if not, that's it. In the mesoscopic regime, the situation is slightly more interesting, but again, the main idea is sort of the same, but then you have to work harder. Why you have to work harder? Okay, let's consider the mesoscopic regime. So we have this parameter ln, which goes to infinity, but slower than n. We consider this, again, let's talk about pair counting statistics, right? So again, using Fourier transform, we can rewrite it in terms of traces of powers of random unitary matrix, right? And then you can see that the powers, okay, proportional to ln play a role, right? So it's not just enough to consider k of order one, right? K can grow here. So formally speaking, you want to replace this sum, this random sum, by the one when you consider complex Gaussian random variables. Therefore, the issue becomes about approximation of the multivariate distribution of the traces of powers of random unitary matrix by appropriate multivariate Gaussian distribution. So it's a question about multivariate normal approximation due to Johansson, Lambert, and several other people. And this could be done if the dimension doesn't grow very fast. And the tool to study it would be Wasserstein distance. So if you have two random vectors, x and y, you can define Wasserstein distance between their distributions. The formula is given here. And again, the issue here is the following. You have your random unitary matrix from circle bit ensemble. You consider this d dimensional random vector, right? You consider traces of powers of u up to u to the power d. And you want to compare this d dimensional vector, complex vector, with the d dimensional complex vector comprised, built from standard complex Gaussians. But okay, you have to normalize them to account for the variance, right? And in what sense these two distributions are close to another, to each other? And one can study Wasserstein distance. And Johansson and Lambert showed that indeed, if D is not that big, then the Wasserstein distance between these two random vectors goes to zero. And there are several other results, particularly due to Webb, and some other people study this, but so this is sort of the main tool. If you have it, then you can work with it and you can prove things. So the most interesting case is the local case. And that's where sort of life becomes complicated and you really have to work harder. And again, mostly I will probably try to write formulas only for pair counting statistics, but the idea doesn't change. Only computation becomes slightly more complicated, but the idea doesn't change really. So what happens here? Again, we consider this pair counting statistic in the local regime, right? So we have n by n random unitary matrix with sum of all pairs of eigenvalues with scale here, right? So in other words, really, since f decays sufficiently fast at infinity, only eigenvalues really close to each other play a role. And so basically nearest neighbors and next to nearest neighbors, etc. But that's about it, right? So even though, of course, you have the number of terms here proportional to n squared, only about the number of terms that sort of play a role is proportional to n, of course. Now, again, as before, you can rewrite it using Fourier transform. And then you face the question about the behavior, asymptotic behavior of the traces of the powers of your random unitary matrix. But now this powers key, they must be proportional to n, right? So terms contribute to the sum in case of order n, right? Okay. This is not completely trivial problem. Even if you want to study the variance of this expression, you have to work and compute the covariance formula for these traces. And this formula is simple when powers are small, but if not, you have to work harder. So just for your convenience, I wrote the formula. So the formula that I just gave on the previous page follows from some tedious computations involving determinantal formulas for k-point correlation functions. But if you want to study limiting fluctuation, you cannot just use these tedious computations. I mean, they can only carry you that far, right? So what's going on is the following. You might want to study the cumulants of this traces of powers of random unitary matrix. So let me remind you that if you have a family of random variables, right, you can study the adjoint cumulants. You can write the adjoint cumulants using combinatorial formula in terms of joint moments, right? Joint cumulants and joint moments are related by appropriate formula when you consider sum of all partitions, right? And these joint cumulants, they're symmetric. They have multilinearity property. And of course, they're particularly simple if your random variables are Gaussian, right? So why they're useful here? Well, as you know, of course, moments of random variables could be written in terms of joint cumulants, right? And in our situation, we recognized that we have to study joint distribution of the traces of high powers of random unitary matrix. And one way to study it is to study joint cumulants of these traces of powers. Okay. And the beautiful fact is that, again, what you need to consider, you need to consider the case when powers are proportional to n, right? So basically, then if you rescale, if you normalize by n everything, then what one can show is that this sort of rescale cumulants, they don't depend on n anymore. So you have explicit formulas for the expression on the left hand side. And this will be a bounded function, which is piecewise linear on appropriate hyperplane and zero everywhere else. And this is useful. So what I mean by this is the following. This rescale cumulants could be written in some quite ugly expression, of course, but it's manageable. Again, this all functions are piecewise linear. All these terms are okay, not super ugly on individually. And if you work more, you can obtain several important facts about this joint cumulants, rescale cumulants, in the bounded functions, symmetric piecewise linear. More importantly, they vanish if the sum of the argument is not zero. For p equal one and two, you have some very similar simple formulas. And just for fun, I think, I give here the formulas for third joint cumulant and fourth joint cumulant. Again, this really follows from pretty tedious computations, but it's doable. But of course, again, that's not enough. I mean, if you want to study fluctuation, you have to do better than this. And so what's going on really is the following. Okay. So here, actually, I wrote the formula for high order correlations before I talked about pair correlations, but then things do not change much. You can assume always that little n, actually, sorry, not m, is 2 here. Consider m's moment, right? What you obtain, as we discussed before, you have to study joint moments of traces of powers. And once you centralize things, these products will be centralized. So you have to subtract appropriate mismatch expectation. So this formula is pretty ugly, but what's going on is that this big mathematical expectation of the third line, you can write in terms of joint cumulants, in terms of rescaled joint cumulants, right? And there is certain combinatorial formula. I'm pretty sure it's available somewhere, but I just had to derive it, but I'm pretty sure it's standard. If you work a little bit, you can show that indeed, if you have to study mathematical expectation of the product of M terms, and each of these M terms is appropriate sum of some random variables minus centralized sum, right? As in the case of just the product of random variables, you can write in terms of cumulants, but now since you have the centering part, you have a twist. It's not the whole sum, you have certain restriction on the partitions that appear. Okay. And it's not super hard to prove it actually. But bottom line is that now, if you go back to the third line on the slide, right, to the upper portion of the slide, and you look at this mathematical expectation of the product of centralized product of trees, you can rewrite in terms of cumulants. And again, the cumulants, we have explicit formulas for these guys. So if you plug it in, you sort of arrive at the following sum. And again, you don't want probably to look at the details, but what I want to say is that this sum looks like a Riemann sum, right? So therefore the issue is to study the linear subspace where we do this integration, because remember these cumulants vanish unless the sum of the arguments is zero. And the question is about the dimension of this subspace, right? So each partition pi gives us a certain linear subspace given by the three equations. And the crucial question in the power counting analysis, if you want to study centered moment, becomes the question about the dimension of this vector subspace, right? Or if you wish, the rank of this system of three equations, and you can do it in general. Nice combinatorial argument, but it's just linear algebra. It's nothing exciting. It's doable. Okay. And basically, just to conclude, I have a few minutes, but to conclude, I will say this. When you consider a given partition pi, you can study an equivalence relation, and it's defined in pretty natural way in this situation. You sort of define in such a way that you can go from one block to another block using this partition. And then we call partition optimal if the cardinality of each equivalence class is 2, and it's not optimal if this condition is not satisfied, then suboptimal. And the punchline is that only optimal partitions give the main contribution to the moments. Suboptimal partitions give sublinear contributions, and sort of I'm basically will finish very soon, but the mathematical reason for this is that for optimal partitions, the linear subspace that appeared a couple of slides ago has dimension given by the maximum possible value, and for suboptimal partitions, it's smaller. And basically, this is the heart of the power counting argument and sort of finishes the picture. So I'm about to finish. I want to add that the question, what happens when bit is not two in the global regime, in the local regime, is open to us. I don't know what to do there. It's a nice problem. But even in the mesoscopic regime, when the factor Ln grows faster than n to the power 2/3, again, it's an open question. So your help will be very helpful. Welcome. So I'm about to stop here. And again, great congratulations to John for his research career and many, many wonderful contributions to mathematics. Just many exciting papers. It's amazing how much one can accomplish. Okay, thank you so much for listening.
Are there any questions?
Excuse me, is it possible to ask a question? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes. Excuse me, Sasha, for a very naive question. So, first of all, unless I'm mistaken, it seems to me that the argument you gave, just without any change except in notation, can be applied to the sign process.
I wouldn't be surprised at all. Right? I wouldn't be surprised at all. If you think about, for example, linear statistics, right? Issue. You can start with sign process and just consider linear statistics there, but just using expanding everything.
Exactly.
Right. Of course, it's the same story, of course.
Yes, but this is first part of my very naive question. But second part, is it possible to... So it seems that your argument relies very heavily on specific formula for the function CP, on this specific formula in terms of maxima of some linear functions. Yes, I think this is the one I mean. Yes, thank you very much. So, but it is completely not clear to me if something can be said about, for example, Bessel kernel or Airy kernel along similar lines, and what could be substitute for this explicit formula?
Yes. I don't know. Because I just don't know. I mean, because some parts of the segment just do not translate. As far as I can see.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Are there questions in the room or
on Zoom? If not, let us thank Sasha again.